You're listening to TIP.
On today's show, I sit down with Mike Russo to learn more about the impending foreclosures and evictions on everyone's minds, real estate auctions, and how this could be useful for new investors anticipating a wave of foreclosures in the near future. Mike is the co-founder of Concierge Auctions and a seasoned real estate pro with over $1 billion of transactions under his belt. He has transformed a luxury auction model into a multifunction survival tool for struggling FSBOs, for sale by owners, and struggling realtors alike. One of the biggest concerns on the minds of investors right now is how COVID-19 is going to impact the real estate market once the eviction moratoriums are up. It's likely going to flood the market with foreclosures, which is unfortunate for those losing their properties, but could be an opportunity for investors with cash or access to financing. Before we get into the episode with Mike, I answer some of the most common questions I receive on Instagram from listeners. If you want to connect with me on social media, you can find me on Instagram with my username, TheRobertLeonard. That's spelled out as TheRobertLeonard. Now, let's get into this week's episode.
You're listening to Real Estate Investing by the Investors Podcast Network, where your host, Robert Leonard, interviews successful investors from various real estate investing niches to help educate you on your real estate investing journey.
Hey everyone, welcome back to the Real Estate 101 podcast. As always, I'm your host, Robert Leonard. And as I mentioned in the intro, before we get into this week's episode with our guest, Mike Russo, I'm going to take some time to answer some of the most common questions that I get from listeners on social media. So let's dive right into the first question. The first question comes from Shreddy. His username is Adventure Time with Shreddy. And he asked, how do you compete with high profile investors scooping up all the smaller deals? It's ridiculous. And this is a great question. One of the reasons why I wanted to answer this is because a lot of people think about this, and it's not always just, you know, high profile investors or bigger investors that are scooping up all the deals. Sometimes there's just a lot of competition in markets. And I like this question because I think it's one thing I've actually done well as an investor, and I can actually speak to it because it's been a big focus for me. And so when people get into real estate, typically as real estate first investors, so if this is where they look to first, if this is one of the first asset classes they get into, meaning like they haven't invested in stocks or, you know, other types of assets that they could potentially invest in, and real estate was the first thing, they typically have this preconceived notion or misunderstanding that you have to invest in your markets or where you live. And so for me, I think I actually have an advantage because I was actually a stock investor first. And you're probably thinking, how does stock investing have any impact on how you compete with high profile investors that are scooping up all the deals like Shreddy asked? Well, the reason it's helped me is because when you invest in the stock market, one of the things that Warren Buffett taught me is to invest where there are less people fishing. And so his portfolio has grown to billions and billions and billions and billions of dollars, even hundreds of billions. So he can't really invest in the super small stocks anymore. But he said publicly in the past that basically if he managed less money, he could compound it to on about 50% per year. And the way he would do that is by buying equities that are undervalued, but they're undervalued because not as many people are looking at these types of securities or companies. And so as a stock investor who has studied Warren Buffett for over a decade now, and that was like my main approach to investing, I wasn't investing in all these companies that a ton of people knew. When I got into real estate, I said, well, why wouldn't I just do the same thing? You know, in the stock market, we look for opportunities where we're not competing with all these other people, meaning these companies are typically not as well followed in the news or not as well written about on the internet or social media. So I said to myself, why wouldn't I do the same thing in real estate? And so it was kind of twofold. It was that, what Warren Buffett taught me about the stock market. And it was also, I heard a quote, and I forget who I heard it from. I want to say it was David Green from Bigger Pockets, but I could be wrong about that. But the quote was basically, it said, live where you want to live and invest where the numbers make sense. And so combining that with the Warren Buffett piece, it's just really spoken to me. And so for one of my very first rentals, I went long distance. I talk about that a lot on social media. I even talk about it here on the show. But basically for my first true rental, I went about 2,000 miles away, maybe more. I live in the greater Boston area up in New England. And my first real rental property outside of house hacks was actually down in Texas. And so why did I do that? Well, because when you're in the stock market investing, you're looking for, like I said, for places where there's not as many people, but it still has to be a good deal. You know, just because there's no people there doesn't mean it's going to be a good opportunity. Maybe there's no people there for a good reason. So when you're analyzing a company in the stock market, it still has to be undervalued. It still has to be a good company. It still has to be a good opportunity. And so it's the same in real estate. So I said, where are other investors not investing that are still good opportunities? And so when you start to research going long distance, one of the first things you'll find is that you should invest in Birmingham, Alabama, Cleveland, Ohio, Indianapolis, Indiana, Memphis, Tennessee, and there's a couple other markets, but there's like four or five, maybe six markets that are very, very common or popular for long distance investors because they're known to have low property values, pretty strong rents. And so that's drawn a lot of attraction from long distance investors. And so when I first started looking into long distance real estate, I said, well, why would I go to these markets? I remember getting asked this. They're like, oh, you're going to go to one of these markets, right? And I was like, no, why would I go there? That's where all of the competition is. I want to find a market like that where there's no competition or much less competition, like a market like that other people haven't found yet. And so what I did was I analyzed those markets and I found out what the demographic data points were that were making those attractive markets. And there was a lot more to it, but some of those things were inventory, property types, property values compared to rent rates and how those two compare. Because if you can get a low priced property for a lot of rent, that typically would be a great rental. And then you want to look at crime rates and job growth and things like that. And so I started to look for those demographics across other cities. And I was taught this strategy by Neil Bawa. He's been a guest on the show a couple times now. And basically, he takes a really data-driven approach to real estate. So I analyzed data for about 7,000 cities or so across the US until I found it was about 10 to 12, maybe 15 that really had met all of the criteria that I wanted. And what I loved about these cities was that nobody was talking about them. If you look online or search across the internet, Bigger Pockets, Google, nobody's talking about any of these cities as, you know, great places to invest. They all flew under the radar, but I knew that the demographic data was great. So that told me there was a good opportunity there. And so basically what I did was I started making offers across, I forget, 5 or 6 or 7 of those markets until one of my deals actually hit. And once it hit, I told myself that I would continue to buy there. And so my business partner and I got a property in Texas and one of the markets that we were making offers in. And ever since then, we've continued to invest. And I'm not saying we're flooded with deals. There's still definitely, you know, it's still hard to get deals because it's a good market, but we're not competing with nearly as many investors as you would in Indianapolis or Cleveland or Birmingham or Memphis, right? We're in a great market. We've had great success in this small market that not a lot of people know about. And we're just not competing with a lot of investors. So how do you compete with high profile investors who are scooping up all the smaller deals? Go to a market where they're not doing that. There are thousands and thousands of cities across the US. Find one that fits the demographic data points that you're looking for and invest there. It's worked for me. I'm going to continue to do it. I'll probably be expanding to other cities soon or eventually, and I'm going to do the same thing. And so how do you compete? You don't. You don't compete with those investors because they have advantages that you don't. So you go where they're not fishing. You go where there's less fishermen. And that's how you're able to get your deals done. I hope that answers your question, Shreddy, and I hope it helps a lot of people listening to the show. The second question comes from, I know I'm going to get this name wrong, but I'm going to try my best. I apologize if I butcher it, but it looks like it's Thanasis Balatosis. Again, my apologies if that is wrong. But the question was, how do you get comfortable with current valuations in real estate with cap rates at all-time lows? I mentioned in my last question how I was really formed or impacted by some of my stock investing experiences and what I learned from Warren Buffett in terms of how to compete and how to not fish where there's other fishermen. And so the answer to this next question actually also was formed or taught to me from Warren Buffett and some of my stock investing experiences. And you actually, you know, here on the show, I talk a bit about how I think I'm a Warren Buffett style value investor in real estate, or I'm a Warren Buffett style real estate investor, or just that I bring value investing principles to real estate. And these first two questions really kind of illustrate why I think that's the case. So how do I get comfortable with current valuations in real estate with cap rates at all-time lows? The answer to that question is by buying good deals. And so I want to tell a quick story about my experience in the stock market and kind of relate that back to real estate. And so back when I was getting started investing in the stock market, I had a little bit of money. I started investing when I was 18. I'd been studying it since I was about 14 to 16. I'd started studying it. Had been saving up my money so that I could start to invest when I was 18. And so I had a little bit of money to invest, nothing crazy, a couple thousand bucks. But because I had studied Warren Buffett, I thought that markets were expensive. We were about 6 or 7 years out of the last stock market crash, the housing crisis, and I thought things were expensive and I thought things were potentially going to crash again. So I sat on the sidelines for a while with just all cash because I thought that there was going to be a better opportunity. And so I didn't like the current valuations, even though there were some companies I liked and I thought that they were good value, but I was more worried about the market as a whole. So I didn't actually invest my money. It took me a few years and then I eventually did bite the bullet and I invested. And ultimately, I realized I had left a lot of gains on the table for a few years while I sat in cash. And so basically, I learned my lesson from that. And that's not to mean you buy at all these crazy valuations. You still want to buy good deals. But you don't want to not buy just because certain things seem overvalued. So if the general stock market overall seems expensive or frothy, which I would argue it does right now, if you find a company that's trading super cheap and you believe in it, that doesn't mean you shouldn't invest. And it's the same with real estate. So just because you might feel that markets are expensive or that cap rates are low or whatever the situation is, if you find a good deal, that doesn't mean you shouldn't buy it. You find a good deal, buy it. And so for me, that was a really big pivot because I basically realized that I can't time the market and nobody can. So if you find a good deal that makes sense and there's good numbers, you should always buy it. Doesn't matter what's going on in the market. And this was further cemented because it was taught to me by Brandon Turner at Bigger Pockets. Basically, he said, if you're not investing right now, or at least this is probably over the last year or so, if you're not investing right now, you're not going to invest when there's blood in the streets or the market crashes. You know, everybody's saying, I'm going to wait for the market crash to invest. And his argument was basically that right now, times are so good. There's so much money out there. It's really easy to get financing. And if you're not able to invest and find deals right now and actually pull the trigger on these deals, when there's blood in the streets and everything is crashing and the economy is crashing, you're not going to be able to buy any deals because one, you have no experience, and two, financing becomes a lot harder to get. So if you're not willing to buy deals in good times, you're probably not going to be willing or able to buy deals in bad times. And so that just further cemented the idea for me and basically told me if I can find a deal with good numbers that make sense, I'm comfortable with real estate valuations being high across the board as long as the numbers make sense. And I couple this with one of my favorite sayings that, you know, I don't know if somebody said it before me, but I haven't heard it anywhere else. So one of the things that I like to say or an idea that I came up with is that you can buy a deal for over asking price and still get a good deal, or you could buy something under asking price and still get a bad deal. And so asking price is really irrelevant. It's really all about the underlying numbers and the underlying value. So if somebody's asking, I'm just going to throw random numbers out there, but if somebody's offering $100,000 for a property, and I know it can rent for $2,000 a month, that's a 2% rule. That's generally probably going to be a good rental property. So if I'm in a bidding war, yeah, I'll offer $125,000. And so I had to pay 25% over the asking price, but the numbers will still probably make sense and it'll still be a great rental. So it doesn't matter to me if I paid over asking, as long as the numbers make sense. So that's really the key piece here is don't buy a bad deal. Don't buy overvalued properties just to get a deal done. But it doesn't matter, in my opinion, what's going on in the real estate markets, as long as you're buying properties with good numbers that make sense. That's how I'm approaching it. I haven't stopped buying deals. I just bought a deal last week. I'll be closing on it this week. We're looking at adding a couple more properties in the next month or two. So I'm still buying deals right now. But again, the numbers have to make sense. I know a lot of people have that question. They're always asking, is now a good time to buy a deal? So I hope that answers your question. And thank you so much for submitting your question to me on Instagram. The third question comes from a gentleman that I will probably also butcher his name, but it looks like it is Nick DePasquale. Nick, sorry for butchering your name, but thank you so much for your question. You asked, if you could put 20% down, do you recommend it? Or would you put a lower percent down? This is really going to be personal preference. Math says one thing, but it really, this is more psychology, I think, than anything. If you really run the numbers, I think it could be pretty obvious in terms of what is optimal from a financial perspective. But that's not always necessarily the right decision. I've come to learn, and that's how I used to think of things. You know, it always had to be optimal financially or numerically or quantitatively. But I've learned that psychology and emotions play a huge role in these types of things. So I've started to put a bit more weight on that type of stuff. So I want to say it depends on the person. For me personally, I like to put the lowest percent down I can. And the reason for that is because I just closed on a property last month, maybe 2 months ago now. And I got a 2.25% interest rate on a fixed 30-year debt. And at the closing table, the lady that was doing the closing from the title team said it was the lowest interest rate she's ever seen on a mortgage. And so why would I put 20% down with such a low interest rate when I could take, maybe put 5% down instead and take that additional 15% and invest it somewhere else that's going to earn me a much higher rate of return than 2.25%. Now, that is the optimal financial decision. That's how I think about it, because I don't mind having a little bit more debt or a little bit higher mortgage payment than some people. But if emotionally, you'd rather just have a little bit more safety by having a lower mortgage payment or having less debt, then that totally works too. However, the only caveat that I would have to this is sometimes I would take a chunk of that, and instead of investing the entire 15%, what I actually do is maybe save 10% of that and put it in an emergency fund so that now my mortgage is covered. Because for me, I like the safety. You know, maybe I buy a property, the mortgage is $1,000 a month. Maybe I take 10% of that and I can put that away. And now maybe I have 6 months of that mortgage covered. So now I feel super secure, so that even though I have a little bit more debt, maybe a little bit higher mortgage payment, at least I know I took some of that down payment that I could have put down. And now instead of having a lower mortgage payment, I actually have 6 months or so. Say it could be 3 months, it could be 9 months, whatever the math works out to. But you have these reserves going into the property. And then I could invest the additional 5% or whatever the percentage is that breaks down to. But you're investing a piece of it. You're also saving some for reserves. So you actually have some safety. And at a 2.25 interest rate on my mortgage, or low interest rates like that, 3%, 3.5%, to me, it just doesn't make sense to pay that down as quick as possible or even to put that much money down. So for me, I typically personally go for the lowest percent down I can. But I understand how some people are a bit more debt adverse and just want to have a lower monthly payment or lower debt. And I think that that's the right decision for you if having a higher mortgage payment and higher debt is going to not help you sleep at night. So really comes down to what's going to really help you be comfortable, help you sleep well at night, and really help you continue to work towards your goals. Nick, thanks so much for asking that question. And now we will get into the fourth and final question. This also comes from an individual who has a last name that I am probably going to butcher. So it seems like all four of these people that submitted questions that I chose this week had hard names to pronounce, but I'm going to try my best. This question came from Holly Brugman. Holly, if I butchered that, my apologies, but thank you so much for submitting the question and the continued support on Instagram. Your question was thoughts on LLCs versus umbrella policy for a new real estate investor. And the reason I want to answer this question is because Again, I have personal experience with this. I love this question, and I know it's on the mind of a lot of investors. I get DMs and emails from people all the time that reach out and say, oh, I just opened my first LLC. I'm ready to invest in real estate. And because my philosophy on this has changed over the years, I'm looking forward to sharing my story and kind of providing my opinion on it. So when I first got into real estate, I had this idea, or I thought that I would never buy a property outside of an LLC. And this is because I didn't really know any better. I had no understanding of really how real estate worked. I didn't know the different options that were available to me. I just knew that LLCs provided some protection, and I knew that I wanted that protection as a landlord. So I basically had this idea in my head that I would never buy a property if it was outside an LLC. And so, you know, I did the same thing a lot of people do. I went out, opened an LLC at my local state, and tried to buy a property. And basically what I found was, if you're buying a property that is less than 4 units, so 1, 2, 3, or 4 units, you will have a very, very, very difficult time getting a mortgage to an LLC. And there are ways around this. I literally just last week bought a property, a single family property with an LLC, but I did not get traditional fixed debt. I went with a little bit more creative debt through a portfolio lender. So it is possible, but typically most of your banks, 99% of the banks you call, your local banks, are not going to lend to an LLC on a property that is 4 units or less. And so that makes it very difficult to get financing. And so that was my first roadblock, was that it was very hard to get financing on that first property. So what did I do? I ended up buying the property in my name, and I said, well, I'll just quick claim deed it to the LLC. And this does violate the due on sale clause, basically meaning that the bank can call the loan fully due if the property is sold, and technically transferring the deed could activate this clause because it's technically a sale from my personal name to my LLC, even though it's the same person. And so typically, and again, this is not legal advice at all, but typically that's not an issue as long as you're making the mortgage payments. It does go against your mortgage, so keep that in mind, but a lot of people do it. And so I decided to do that. And then what I found out was that because my property was long distance, I had to also file with the state that the property was in, as well as my local state that I had the LLC in, and then it was going to cost a couple $100 up to $1,000 for the LLC paperwork in the additional state. And the property was going to cash flow like $3,000 a year or so. And so we're going to lose like a third of our cash flow a year just to this one legal registration. Or maybe it was going to cash flow like $4,000 or $5,000 and we're going to lose $1,000. So we're losing 20 to 25% of our cash flow just to this LLC registration requirement. And so we were like, well, what are we going to do? And so what we ended up doing was, through the podcast, actually, I'd spoken with a lot of guests and asked them what was the best solution. And basically, they said, just get an umbrella policy. A lot of times, it provides very similar protection. As long as you get a good policy, you're just as well covered with an umbrella policy as you are with an LLC. So just be well insured and you're fine. So that's what we ended up doing. My business partner and I bought the property in our personal names. We ended up not quit claiming it. Well, we did quit claim it, but we quit claimed it back to our personal names. And then we just got an umbrella policy with like $1 million or maybe $2 million in liability coverage. And that's what we've done. And so even as I continue to scale my portfolio, that's what I would continue to do. The only reason I've slightly changed it now is because I'm considering bringing in outside investors. So I've had some people that are interested in partnering on some deals with me. And so I'm going to need a LLC structure to allow for those investors to buy into the deals. But if I'm just buying deals for myself, or just me and my business partner with no outside investors, we'll just keep it in our personal names, and then we'll just keep our umbrella policy, maybe increase it a little bit depending on how big the portfolio gets. But yeah, so for us, we're just really keeping it in our personal names. Way easier to get financing. You get much better financing, much better terms, and you still really get the good protection as long as you get a good umbrella policy. And I was shocked to learn how cheap an umbrella policy actually was. I don't have the exact numbers, but I was it's very affordable in comparison to what I originally thought. I thought that the umbrella policy was going to be significantly more expensive than it was, and it really wasn't too bad. So Holly, to answer your question, I tend to fall on the umbrella policy side, keep the things in your own name. Again, I'm not a legal professional, I'm not a tax professional, I'm not an insurance professional, so speak with all of these professionals before you make a decision, do your own due diligence. But that was my experience. Those are the things that I learned as I've grown my portfolio, and that's how I personally approach it with my own properties. I know that question, like I said, is very, very popular from a lot of people, so I hope that helps you guys. I hope that helps you, Holly, as well as everybody else that has that question. If you have any questions about this last piece that I talked about, or really any of the four questions, be sure to send it to me on Instagram. My username is @TheRobertLeonard. That's just TheRobertLeonard. And I will happily get back to you in the DMs or in a comment on my post. And if you want to have your question here on the show, feel free to send it to me and I will pick some in future episodes as well. All right, so that wraps up the Q&A section for this week's episode. Now, let's get into the conversation with Mike Russo. Mike, welcome to the show.
Hi, thanks for having me.
When Billy, who's your director of community outreach, reached out to me, the thing that really caught my attention in his email was when he said, and I quote, "Mike has a certified fresh perspective and potential fix to the likely incoming wave of foreclosures. I know foreclosures have been on the minds of a lot of investors, so I'm looking forward to that part of our conversation. But before we get there, let's start by learning a bit more about you. Tell us your story, who you are, and how you got to where you are today."
Who I am is I'm a proud father of five and husband. How I got to where I am today and started in real estate started about 15, 16 years ago. I worked for a really big company, and 2 months into it, it was called Sendent at the time. And 2 months into it, my entire department got let go. I was fortunate enough to be offered a position as the vice president of Coldwell Banker for the Midwest because my company owned Century 21, Coldwell Banker, and ERA at the time. It was 2003. And then in February of 2004, we bought the rights to Sotheby's International Realty. And I immediately was moved into that. I moved to Aspen in 2006 and wound up owning the Sotheby's International Realty franchise through the crash and into 2009. Really not so much fun. And I actually think I coined the phrase that nobody actually needs to own a house in Aspen. And in 2010, I became a partner at Concierge Auctions, which is the largest luxury real estate auction firm in North America. And I sold my interest in that in 2017. Here I am today with SparkOffer.
On your website, it says, "SparkOffer is the only online real estate marketplace where home sellers, buyers, and their agents can buy and sell homes directly with one another." To me, when I was researching and getting prepared for this conversation, on the surface, that doesn't sound too much different than how it's currently done. We go on Zillow or a similar platform, then send an offer directly to the seller or the seller's agent. So how is your service different, and what is the problem that it's solving?
So mine's all done on the platform, right? So you can go to Zillow and you can shop for homes, but you can't transact. And so my goal with SparkOffer was to bring more of the transparency and ease of the auction process into the standard offer process. So today, a buyer can come directly to one of the properties on our site, and they can make an offer right through the platform. That they'll go through a basic offer process, and that offer goes directly to the seller. Whether they have a listing agent including them on the platform or they're doing it themselves, it goes directly to the seller. And they can have a counter offer process right electronically on the system. And you know, they either come to a conclusion or they don't. So really, that is the speed. The other part in regards to the transparency is that anybody that's following a property on SparkOffer, when an offer is made on that property, they're immediately alerted that an offer has been made on this property. And so there were so many times through my history where people would say, "Hey, I was watching that property," or "if I only knew," what have you. And now there's no excuse if they're using SparkOffer not to know that an offer has been made. And so we see a couple things through that on our platform. Number one is half the offers are from buyers directly. In comparison to the traditional process, you know, most people are going to an agent because they're not really sure what to do. So that's number one. Number two is 65% of our properties before this wave of multiple offers right? 65% of our properties were getting multiple offers, where an offer came in, it alerted the people following it, and usually within 24 hours, a second offer would be received.
How does a platform like this work with different states having different forms that you need to submit for an offer? I know I buy property in Texas, also in New Hampshire, Massachusetts. When we submit an offer, typically we have a different offer letter that we provide to the seller, and it's state by state basis. Does the platform like this work in that same way?
So right now I stay completely away from that, because now if I wanted to go to Texas or Colorado, the forms there are provided by the state. So if I wanted to use those direct forms, I could, because I wouldn't be violating any copyright or any other rules of copyright, really. Compared to here in Massachusetts, where most of the offer, like the offers where I live, you know, by the Cape, are different than what's done in Boston, right? Why? Because the local association is providing the forms, and the real estate agents are using the forms that are customary in that, even in that local pod. It's not even statewide. In New York or in Greenwich, Connecticut, they don't use offers at all. They email general offers. So in our case, we have a two-page offer. It would probably be closer to akin to a letter of intent. It does say that it's non-binding. The purpose of it is to really put down in writing, signed by the buyer with proof of funds, to say, I want to buy your house. This is what I want to pay. I want a contingency. I want an inspection. I want to get a mortgage, whatever it is. But there's not a ton of terms in these things, right? And so then my core belief is two grown-ups, or three or four, if you will, with the agents involved, can take the basis of that and move it forward to standard purchase and sale.
And does a property have to be listed by a seller on SparkOffer, or can they make a SparkOffer through a property that's listed elsewhere, and maybe that seller gets a notification and says, hey, you have an offer on your property from this platform?
I wish I could do that, but no, it has to be on our site because I don't have the seller's information.
For those listening, and I think this might be part of that answer, who don't know what the MLS is, and maybe they've heard it before, just not really quite sure exactly what it is. It's thrown around so often in the real estate space. Explain to us what the MLS is and how it works.
So that's a great question. The number one, I will tell you, I haven't posted it. I did write about a couple months ago a blog post saying that the MLS is a closed-door social network, which is really what it is. And so the MLS is either privately owned or owned by a local board of realtors, and it stands for multiple listing service. And it started out as books, and it transitioned to electronic today. But what it was really meant for was that agents would cooperate on sharing their listings with each other, and that there was a basic promise that to say, hey, if I put out that I'm going to pay someone 3% for bringing me a buyer, that I was putting that out to the rest of the real estate agents in my area, and that there was some governing body and rules that they couldn't that the listing agent couldn't violate, and everybody would have basic fair play. So that's what the history of the MLS is. But what it is it is today a place where a listing agent, whether that's a full service listing agent, a discount listing agent, an entry only listing agent, goes and puts somebody's house for sale, primarily to share that with the other agents in the area that they can have a buyer to bring to that property. What's predominantly happening today, and this is a big part of a difficult part of the value proposition that listing agents are incurring today, is that they're being viewed in a lot of cases that they're only listing the house, somebody's house for sale in the MLS, which besides being broadcast to the other local realtors, it is feeding to Zillow, Trulia, Realtor.com, Redfin, because they're a member of the MLS. And that's where the majority of the buyers are looking for property today. And so somebody sees that property, and most of the time, and we've got proven use cases with SparkOffer that they call their buyer's agents and say, hey, I'm interested in this house. But predominantly buyers are finding their own homes on the internet because of it.
That leads exactly into my next question, where another aspect of what you're offering is that you promote and advertise the property yourself if you're the seller or your agent or whoever's placing the property on the platform. One of the things that I personally like about the MLS is that Zillow and realtor.com, Redfin, all these other platforms, they do all the work for me as the seller. I don't have to advertise my property at all. They already have millions and millions and millions of users on their platforms, just like you said, that gives the property massive exposure already. So how is promoting your property yourself more beneficial to you as a seller?
It's not so much promoting it by yourself. So one of the things that I learned from my old business and a lot of people that tend to have used SparkOffer to this point is the MLS and the Zillow have failed them. It's not magic, right? Not everybody's house just automatically gets absorbed and sold in multiple offers just because you posted it there. And, you know, there's a lot going on and every market is different. So what I mean by that is, for example, one of our first houses we did was in Lake Mayopac, New York. And this gentleman had his house for sale for $3.2 million. In fact, if you go to sparkoffer.com, there's a white paper that we wrote about this exact use case on like the challenge with pricing. And the challenge for this gentleman in pricing is that nobody really buys $3 million houses in Lake Mayopac, New York. In fact, maybe they buy a $1.5 million house. And so I used to liken the internet to having a storefront on Fifth Avenue. And if I have a storefront on Fifth Avenue and I buy the right merchandise and I price it right and I put it in my window, there's going to be a lot of people going by. And if I met those criteria, they're going to come in and buy what we have to sell. Works awesome. But you know, if you go two blocks off Fifth Avenue, it's not so many people going by. And it's harder to get attention, even if I bought the right stuff at the right price, or maybe I bought the right stuff, but I priced it too high. And those things affect whether your house is found on the internet today. And so those certain people, they need to have a different mechanism or a different strategy and different tactics to have their house found. Doesn't necessarily magically work all the time.
Now, I want to get into the conversation that I mentioned at the very beginning of the show. There are a lot of people concerned that once foreclosures are allowed again and the eviction moratoriums are lifted, we're going to see a massive wave of foreclosures hit the market and evictions taking place. What is your perspective on this? What do you see as a potential fix?
So this is something that I have a lot of feeling and passion around. So the part that I left out of my initial introduction is in 2009, I was risking losing my home. I was risking foreclosure and I had to short sell my house. It was a very painful process. And then I went into the auction business and I was doing predominantly, you know, very expensive homes. But, you know, after the crash, a lot of these people were also experiencing very difficult times and there was some type of financial distress and we were auctioning their home. And so, there's a number of things. So number one, we've built another platform besides SparkOffer. We actually have built an auction platform. It's called Spark Auction. And I actually think for these people that are facing foreclosure, I have a number of bits of advice. Number one, based on what I've seen in my experience, is they tend to wait too long, right? And they're just hunkered down and just waiting for the bank to take their house. I'm just going to live here as long as I can. That's a tactic. The other is, do I take this head on? And you can take it head on in a number of ways. Now, one is you can put it for auction and set your own rules. And you can set your own reserve. You can put it out to the marketplace because there's more investors than I've ever seen in my lifetime out there. I mean, we're getting the most lead flow that we get for each one of our platforms on SparkOffer and Spark Auction is investors looking for properties. So there's more out there than ever before. There's nothing better than to present of an open competition that will drive a transparent best price. Absolutely. Number two, a lot of these people that are facing this, God willing, actually have some equity in these homes because, and right now, that definitely should be the case compared to what we went through after 08, which was definitely not the case. And so that's what I think from my perspective, it's take it head on, use tools that work fast, force investors to compete. Don't take offers from just somebody quietly because you feel you know, embarrassment of your particular situation, and you're going to take, that may not be best for you. This might be the only equity to get you restarted in your life. And the other part of hitting it head on is that if you don't have enough equity and you do have to short sell it, short selling is far better on your long-term credit than going through a foreclosure.
Things like this are nearly impossible to time. So I think it's a bit unfair of me to even ask this next question. And I don't necessarily want people listening to the show to try and time the market. But based on your experience, when do you think the wave of foreclosures is going to happen, if at all?
I think it's hard to say that it's not going to happen when you have still nearly 3 million people in pandemic forbearance. To say that it doesn't happen, I think would be extremely wishful thinking. I think what you're going to see first is you're going to see a wave of short sales first and then go on to foreclosures. And, you know, I'm pretty tied into a lot of big companies with relationships over the years. And that's certainly what a lot of these big companies are planning. That is going to happen. When do I think it'll happen? You know what? It's really going to wind up in the hands of the administration, the government, of how far they can keep kicking the ball down the field to delay this. And they've been delaying it for quite some time for the pandemic forbearance to stay in place. Personally, I think that's got to probably end sometime mid this year. Maybe, I know the president has thrown out there September, and then, you know, start the foreclosure process from there. So people certainly could be in their homes till later this year, if not next year, and in some states even longer. Although I would say, compared to what we went through 10, 12 years ago, the banks have their act together much better. So those delays for, you know, maybe a missing signature or whatever, like there was all kinds of stories and there was a gazillion of them. I don't think those are going to happen this time around.
You mentioned that 3 million figure of people who have taken advantage of the forbearance program that's being offered. I've heard similar things. I've heard roughly 30% of all mortgages. Whatever data source you're using, it's a big number. There's a lot of people that are taking advantage of the forbearance program. At first, when I heard that number, I was like, wow, this is not going to end well at all. And then I started to think about it a little bit more. I started to talk to some people that I know, and this is going to be pretty anecdotal, I'd say, but I started to talk to some people that I know that have mortgages, and there's quite a few people that I know that aren't necessarily struggling from the pandemic. They've still got their job. Everything is fine, more or less. But they've taken advantage of this forbearance because they figured, why not? Why wouldn't I just stack aside this cash? Do you think that that is truly just anecdotal, or do you think that might be a good portion of that 3 million that are in forbearance?
I don't know. I can tell you that in the tough times that I had after the last crash, I did get to enter into whatever the program was by Obama at the time to try and restructure my mortgage. I didn't get to be in it just because I said so. They made me jump through a lot of hoops. And so while it's probably like unemployment, right? There's probably quite a few people that are claiming unemployment that really aren't unemployed, but I think it's probably a fair portion. Even if you're right and say like there's a third of those people, there's still 2 million people that aren't.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, a third would probably be a lot. You know, I don't know if it's that high. Maybe it is, maybe it's not. But even if it was that high, you're right. There's still 2/3 or 2 million people that really do need the forbearance program. So that's still going to be a major issue. And part of the reason that I was even thinking about this is because I looked into the program just so I could learn as to like what they were requiring to do it. I haven't needed to do the program, thankfully, but it didn't seem like it was very difficult. It seemed like they were more or less letting pretty much everybody do it without much documentation or proving anything.
I hadn't looked into it. I just assumed.
Yeah, and that's what I assumed as well, but it seems relatively easy, but I could be wrong. If you were a new investor listening to the show right now and you're hearing all this talk about a potential recession and a wave of foreclosures, how would you go about entering the market? Would you wait to buy your first deal, or is now a good time to start as well?
It's funny that you asked that, because when I left my last auction firm, I actually did start investing more in real estate. I already had owned some single family rentals, but it was my first time actually going and buying a house to flip. I built a couple new condos. I don't think that there's anything wrong with being in the market today. My number one thing, and some of the best builders, some of the best everything, and you always meet somebody that says, you know what, I can build it cheaper than everybody else. Maybe that's true, maybe it's not true. What I will tell you is that successfully investing in a piece of real estate that you're going to buy, improve, and sell quickly, making your money on that has everything to do with analyzing the market up front, doing a great job of knowing what the market looks like, and number one. And number two, how well did you buy that piece of real estate? Because every time I've been around a situation where somebody got hurt on buying, improving, and flipping a piece of real estate, they didn't buy it very well.
That's pretty much how I'm thinking about it too, is if the numbers make sense, then now's an okay time to buy. I think the issue back then was people were buying deals that didn't make sense from a numbers perspective. But as long as you buy a good deal with good numbers, I think maybe it wasn't the perfect time to buy, but as long as it's a good deal, the numbers make sense, and you maybe even put it through a stress test, I think now's a good time to buy.
The other thing that I always did with all the things that I invested in was I looked at it when I bought it, and maybe it's harder to do this now, even though it's only been a few years since I was doing it, is to say, I used to say, okay, if I can't sell this, if I can't sell it for my profit, can I cover my basis and rent it? What does that look like as an alternative strategy? Because if you can only afford this really for a short time and you wind up not being able to sell it quick enough, and you can't afford, if the rent's not going to allow you to carry whatever it is and you can't afford it, then you have a real problem.
I want to learn a little bit more about your experiences with auctions and real estate. Typically, when you hear of auction properties in real estate, they're run down or being auctioned off because the previous owner couldn't pay for it anymore, whether it be the mortgage payment, property taxes, or something else. You were working with auctions for luxury homes. Were these the same types of transactions that I just described above with just really expensive properties? Or was it an alternative way for a seller to sell their house rather than listing it the traditional way?
So that's a good question. So they did list it the traditional way and it didn't sell. And so what I tell people in relation to what you would deem the traditional way is, and some of the gripes that agents are getting today from their client when their house doesn't sell, they only tell them to lower the price. Now going based on what you said in relation to, you know, Zillow and all these people have millions of people on their website. Well, if you have a list price for your house and you start dropping the price and you drop it and you drop it to the point where somebody sells it, well, that's a Dutch auction is what it is. The people going to the luxury houses in comparison, where is there something wrong with them? Do they owe back taxes, all this stuff? The answer is no. You know, I auctioned Michael Jordan's house in Highland Park years ago. I auctioned Kurt Warner's personal home in Paradise Valley in Arizona. I auctioned a spec house for Nick Saban in Georgia. And, you know, none of these guys were distressed. It's just that they had a buyer. There's two types of auctions. There's two reasons to auction. So number one is, in today's world, every multiple offer situation is an auction done poorly. I would tell you they're better off doing an auction, number one. Number two, the other type is you have something rare and not a lot of buyers, and it's hard to value. And there's a lot of homes in America that meet that criteria that it's just something that's hard to value. I had the fortune after I left my old company to represent a buyer in what is now, it was the largest luxury real estate purchase at auction in America at the time. As of last week, it's now the second, but the property was in Florida on the market for $160 million. And we bought it for, you know, $42 million was the gavel price at auction at that particular, you know, again, few buyers, hard to value.
Having dealt with sellers who own some of the most luxurious homes in the country, other than the few that you just mentioned, Nick Saban, Michael Jordan, I think a lot of people know what they do. What was a common theme you saw in terms of how they built their wealth? Was there a specific thing that many of these wealthy individuals did to earn their wealth?
I used to joke and say there was either one or two things, and they're both actually pretty similar. Either one, they built a company. They built some company to something fantastic, right? And it ranged anywhere from, you know, multi-billion dollar company to my client that I mentioned that bought the home in Florida, sold his company for $700 million, and other people for, you know, $100 million. So they had an idea, they built a company, they worked hard, they built a company, they sold it. took it public, something like that. The other correlation we used to joke is that the people went to Harvard Business School. And so, but usually they were working in some kind of company, equity firm, something around businesses. Those are the two primary things that we saw.
When you think back on your life, whether it be personally, business, or real estate related, what piece of advice have you received that has really had an impact on you and you continue to use it and think of it to this day?
I wouldn't say it would be a particular piece of advice that I've been given. When I was in Aspen, my business partner had almost died of cancer. At one point, he was given 24 hours to live, and that was 15 years ago. He's still here today. When the market crashed and we lost everything, that was my guiding light. And I basically have three rules that I wake up with every day. I tell everybody that they're having a bad day, which is, you know what? If you have a roof over your head and food on the table and your family's healthy and safe, then everything's great. So it's not a particular piece of advice, but it is what guides me.
Mike, thanks so much for joining me on the show today, talking through a new way that we could potentially see the real estate world changing in terms of buying and selling properties in the future, and then also an insight into auction properties that aren't necessarily just, you know, on the courthouse steps. For those listening that are interested in learning more and want to connect with you, where's the best place for them to go?
They can go to sparkoffer.com, email me at mike@sparkoffer.com are the two best ways to get in touch with me.
I'll put a link to those resources in the show notes. I'll put some related resources as well in the show notes for you guys to dive a little deeper if you're interested in this content. Mike, thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you so much for having me. It was great.
All right, guys. That's all I had for this week's episode of Real Estate Investing. I'll see you again next week.
Thank you for listening to TIP. Make sure to subscribe to We Study Billionaires by the Investors Podcast Network. Every Wednesday, we teach you about Bitcoin, and every Saturday, we study billionaires and the financial markets. To access our show notes, transcripts, or courses, go to theinvestorspodcast.com. This show is for entertainment purposes only. Before making any decision, consult a professional. This show is copyrighted by the Investors Podcast Network. Written permission must be granted before syndication or rebroadcasting.
Thanks for watching. Make sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell so you don't miss out on our next podcast episode and new investing resources. What are your takeaways and thoughts about this discussion? Let us know in the comments section below.